Funky Politics. Time's on slipping
into the future. Hey, 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 we are back with a brand new episode of Funky Politics. That's right, folks. Funky Politics emanating all the way. Well, I used to be on the 41st floor. You know, I took a day off. I come back to put me on the first floor. I don't know how brother moved from the top down to the bottom suite, but I'm here. I'm still here, folks. They can't put me out because really I'm the show. No, the show's not all about me. The show's always all about you. So this is what we got today. I was looking in my Rolodex of thoughts and I was trying to figure out, do I go to California? Do I go to Florida? Well, the governor now, he's going to close the beaches down again in California. Because guess what? Some of you people who are not experiencing this idea about social distancing, well, you crowded the beaches a weekend ago. So he said, you know what? I got you. We're going to close them down. But now guess what? There is hope for you. You can always go to Florida. Always go to Georgia. You can go to Texas. Texas down to Galveston area. They're going to open the beaches so you can come out and walk the beach. Now, you can't sunbathe. You can't take your chair. You can't take your cooler full of burr. You can't do any of that stuff. But guess what? You can go out and enjoy the water. I'm good on that. I'm just going to wait, y'all, until all this stuff is blown over. Right now, social distancing is still the norm. Washing those damn hands 20 seconds every time is still the norm. Having you some nice stuff that you can put on your hands, like they call hand sanitizer, is still the norm, and also the mask. But please, social distancing. Now, I believe we're flattening this curve. We're going to be back to business before you know it. I know we're going to be back to business before you know it. Other than that, 45 is still doing his thing, whatever that may be. I'm not sure he knows what he's doing, but we're going to keep an eye on him. VP Joe Biden, he's got a little bit of an issue right now. Tara Reid, a young lady, came out and said in 93 that he had some inappropriate actions with her. And some people are starting to say, hey, look, Mr. Vice President, you need to come forth and talk about this. So the vice president, the next several weeks, will be dealing with this issue. But I believe he'll weather the storm. A lot of folks say they believe him. I read a lot of the case and it looks like there may have been something, but I'm not so sure it rose to the level of what she considers to be sexual assault. But again, I'm not the investigators. We'll see what happens. Good luck, Joe Biden, on what you got to do, brother. But talk to the public. Talk to the people. They want to know. You look like you're going to be the Democratic nominee. And we need you to do something in November that nobody's done. And that is to defeat 45. But hey, folks, look, let's get down to funky politics. We've got a young brother on today. Brother's a noob. Brother's a Kappa man. But anyway, brother is a noob. Yo. We got Ryan Robertson, who happens to be he emanates out of a wonderful city in the South called Memphis, but he finds his work now in New York. And so we're going to have Ryan Robertson, who happens to be the innovation director for Diageo and Multicultural Affairs. And this brother right here knows his thing when it comes to marketing and how to get segmentation marketing going. And so we're going to talk to him about a lot that he's doing in the New York sphere. We're going to talk about the alcohol industry or the spirit industry. Some of y'all, I need to tell y'all alcohol, because some of y'all be thinking Holy Spirit. No, I'm talking about the spirit. But we'll be back with more of Funky Politics and my very special guest, Ryan Robertson, on Funky Politics.
R&R on Sports.
Brother Rashad McCants, welcome to R&R on Sports.
Thanks for having me, brother.
It's R&R on Sports.
You're listening to Funky Politics.
Funky Politics.
Funky Politics.
Funky Politics.
Powered by the Kudzukian Network.
Okay with it. We are back with Funky Politics. And as I promised you, my very special guest today is Ryan Robertson. Ryan is he's no stranger to marketing. He's no stranger to corporate America. He's no stranger to us here at Kudzukian, nor is he any stranger to the brothers out there. The noobs know him. Yo, Ryan Robertson, welcome to Funky Politics, good brother. How are you?
Yo, DC, thanks for having me. I'm great. I'm well. Well, as well as one can expect in these times.
Well, when they say in the church, it's in these divers times, right?
See, exactly. Like in the church. You know, that's what we do in Memphis.
Man, that's what we do, bro. That's what we do. Hey,
thanks for having me. I'm happy to be on here. Fan of Funky Politics. So just excited to be here.
Hey, look, man, the work you have done in spreading joy and cheer around the world. Let me just tell you from a personal standpoint, appreciate you, dude. Appreciate you.
Thank you. I appreciate that, man.
Let's get right down to it. Let's talk about COVID-19, let's talk about the spirit industry. And I think we were talking a little bit offline a second ago. The spirit industry has really, and when I mean spirit, and we're talking about alcohol, folks, has done a pretty good job of maintaining jobs and maintaining a lot of us who have some senility right now, because we got a couple of things on the shelf back that we can go and partake in. But right. COVID-19 really has not, or has it really affected the bottom line of the spirit industry?
Yeah, so I think it's interesting because it is, when you think about spirits is kind of a complex category, right? Because sure. you got manufacturers like Diageo, the company I work for, that sells to distributors that then sell to the retail outlets. But essentially, what has happened is you have kind of like the bars and clubs and restaurants, right? Which we call
on-premise.
And that's dead, essentially, because the restaurants and people are not sitting in restaurants drinking, right? So bars are not open. But the majority of the volume in the U.S. for spirits is sold in grocery stores and liquor stores and that kind of thing, which we call off-premise. Those sales, as you say, are up dramatically. And we've also seen a big uptick in online sales, too, because of kind of convenience and people want the spirits delivered to their houses and things like that. So generally, to your point, it is sales have been for the last, let's say, month and a half. Sales have been really good in the spirits industry here in the U.S. The thing is, we're not sure what we're trying to really understand, and we need a little bit more data and time to really understand that is if this is a result of stock up. So people kind of at the beginning of this really going out shopping, stocking up so that they could have it ready when they needed it, or whether this will be ongoing through the pandemic. So are they going to continue to go to the liquor store because they need more? So what we don't know if the big bump that we saw was just due to stock up. So we need a little bit more time to really understand that. And then I think the other thing that we're seeing in the industry is instead of kind of physical happy hours, people are doing a lot of virtual and digital things, right? So you see a lot of virtual happy hours pop up and things like that. So that's really the effect that we've seen thus far in the industry based on this pandemic.
So you're saying that when I went to my favorite store of passion and liquor store, that's not passion anyway, and I bought this case or two, possibly three. I don't know which one it was, but that there's a possibility that I stocked up and that because I bought so much, I may not be a return customer in a period of time for that same three case, right? Is that what we
exactly? You may be out of the market for a period of time, right? So who's to say whether the next 2, 3, 4 months in the spirits industry is going to be down because people may have stocked up. So we don't know whether that's the case or whether people just bought. And then as soon as they out of this one bottle, they're going to go back. So it's going to be continuous. So that's still to be determined.
I want to stay right there a minute also on off-premise. And I like how you brought that out, because a lot of folks in some of these local towns and, you know, cities, even the big ones, Chicago, New York, people will say, all right, for you to be a bar, or a restaurant, and the litmus test is, what was your sales in terms of liquor and what was your sales in terms of food, right? And so if you sold more liquor, then you considered a bar. If you sold more food, you considered, I guess, a restaurant. So you're good to open. But now you've got these mixed messages now with these restaurants. You can open, but your bar can't open. But now you can still open the restaurant part. But most folks, they know that primarily the money is made with the spirit part, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think what you're seeing now as a result of that, you're seeing restaurants and establishments actually getting pretty creative. So their bars not physically being open, but I know there are several restaurants in New York and recently, due to this, the governor has changed the law where you can actually get carry out alcoholic beverages with your carry out food, right? So I went to a Mexican restaurant to do carry out a couple of weeks ago, and I was able to get a to-go margarita, which you can't do that. It's illegal typically in New York, but I know a lot of states have made kind of accommodations for that given this time period. And I do think that potentially that behavior will continue, right? So there will potentially be states opening up more ability for consumers to kind of take to-go beverages out to carry home and enjoy at home and things like that. So I think that this may actually spur some longer term changes or relook at some of the things, right? So instead of New Orleans being really the place where you can do that, you'll be able to do that in many different cities.
Well, I want to jump in here. I want to jump because I know for instance, knowing your folks, and I want to make sure that Miss Bev and Howard Nana, by the way, I'm gonna call him Nana right now. We'll get into that. but I know for sure you walked with that margarita. You didn't drive your car.
I'm in New York. And I didn't open it till I got back to my house.
Are there any particular brands or categories that you all have seen in the data right now that have even beer that has taken off and really shot out the roof? Or there's some that just kind of said, no, we don't really like that now that we're sheltered in. Have you seen that yet in the data?
Yep. So I think what we've seen generally is like those more familiar or popular or known brands tend to fare better in these times, right? So the brands that are known, they're familiar, people know them. They tend to purchase those in times like this. I think the newer, the smaller brands are the brands that are more susceptible or brands that are more at risk during these periods because consumers are not wanting to try anything new right now, right? Wow. They want to go with what they know. And then I think that that like those luxury and ultra premium spirits, which a lot of our portfolio is comprised of, I think that those are probably going to take longer. Well, in the short term, I'll say, and by short term, I mean between the now and the next like 9 months. I think we'll start to see those decrease just because discretionary income right now is not. Sure. Is not readily available or as immense as it has been. I think from a category standpoint, I think you see what we have seen is we've seen more sales in like the whiskey space and the brown spirit space because of and I think that's because of the at home occasion, right? Those are the spirits where you can kind of chill out and enjoy and sip and savor versus something like vodka, which is typically like more of a high energy party night out type of spirit. So I think from a category standpoint, brown spirits has kind of seen a slight bump over the rest.
The trouble with me is that I liked the brown and the clear spirits, and sometimes I don't know what spirit I am in.
That's absolutely fair, and that's like me too. It just depends on what the
flavor of the day, Doc. The flavor of the day. So from an innovative standpoint, let's talk about innovation. What opportunities, even in this, and we still have to preface this COVID-19 because things have changed so much so that I don't think we ever go back to what we used to do. And which is, we were just talking about how now some of these states are relaxing some of the to-go alcohol orders, right? Same thing in the South. I mean, you can take. This was unheard of, walking out of a door with your shot of whatever you got or your glass, unheard of. So what are the innovative type things are on the horizon, you think?
Yeah, so I think convenience, I think, is still going to be paramount. So products or solutions that make things easier for consumers, because it's important right now because you got a lot of people that are, look, parents, teachers, janitors, cooks, like all at the same time. And so I think we as marketers and innovators have to create solutions for consumers that make it easier, right? So instead of a consumer having to learn how to, I'll give you an example in the spirits industry, instead of a consumer having to go online and look to a website or go to YouTube and look for a recipe and get all these different things, is there a kit that we can do that provides everything and they can just do it right there, right? That they can just buy that kit and just do their cocktail recipe there. So I think that's just one example, but convenience I think is gonna remain paramount. So I think that's an opportunity for innovators. I think smaller size for products, just because especially new products, I think given the reticence to try new and different things and commit to kind of a big 750 milliliter of a spirit, I think smaller, it opens up opportunities for smaller sizes from an innovation standpoint. And I think something that's interesting is gifting. Like, are there any kind of interesting or cool gifting solutions that we can provide to consumers? Because I think in this time, people want to show support and appreciation of others. So instead of just kind of a bottle of this spirit, how do we decorate it and make it nice so that it's ready to be gifted to somebody? Because I think that the psyche of us in this time is really more towards altruism and giving back and making sure we're showing appreciation as well. So I think that's just a few opportunities that I see on the horizon from an innovation standpoint.
I want to pivot a little bit because Ryan, you come from a very parents are pretty successful, and what you have been able to garner in your short space. What do you say to those young folks who are juniors and seniors in college, and they're looking to make their jump from just straight college, sometimes maybe not even an internship. I want to go to the big city. I want to make it like Ryan made it. In your walk, I mean, you didn't just walk into Diageo as the VP of multicultural affairs. You didn't just walk into that. There was a buildup, no doubt, right?
Yep.
Absolutely. What advice would you give those young folks out there right now that are looking to cut their teeth in corporate America, whether it's spirits or it's logistics or rather it's supply chain?
Yep. I would say, get in when I think that we always have in our minds, at least I did in college, like exactly what I wanted, right? I want to do this and I want to be there. Yeah. And marketing was always, marketing was always what I wanted to do. But I think that you have to kind of relinquish some of those expectations initially and earlier on and take the opportunities as they're presented to you, right? So I actually started, my career at Procter & Gamble, kind of the biggest CPG company right now in the world. But great experience, but I didn't start in I knew I wanted to go to marketing, but my opportunity to get into the company was actually in supply chain. It was in procurement or purchasing. I didn't know anything about that, but that was my opportunity in. So I took that. I did that for 2 years. I got that experience. I was subsequently able to shift and transfer into marketing, but had I not taken that opportunity, I think I wouldn't be where I am today. My path would have been very different. So I think that my advice would be, I definitely understand, and I think knowing kind of where you want to go ultimately is important, but I think that take the opportunities that arise that are given to you, and you can always kind of pivot and work your way through. But I would say, like, if it's not exactly what you wanted to do off top, don't just shun it and don't decline it, because I think there's beauty in different experiences, which you may not understand at the time, but it'll become much more relevant as you progress.
Now you're in New York City, no doubt. When you work for P&G, were you in the Cincinnati market? Because P&G is in Ohio. Cincinnati?
Yep. I was unfortunately in Cincinnati.
A lot of people say that about Cincinnati. We don't want to talk about the Mars shots of the world. This is Funky Politics, by the way. And I'm not sure. Rest her soul, Lord. She's dead and gone. Y'all remember Mars was the old Cincinnati Reds owner and I know about racist. But anyway, enough about her. So all of these, my young people, they want to know, does it matter if I leave school? You didn't come back to Memphis, no doubt. You didn't come back home, but you did stay out and you did progress around the country somewhere to now where you're in New York. So how do we get our young people to say it's okay to leave your school and leave the roost and go somewhere and try to make it? But it's okay if you have to come back, right?
Yep.
Have you had those conversations when you were a kid? I'm sure you had those conversations with Howard and Beverly, right? Mom, I'm going to go out and do this thing.
Right. And my parents were really big on kind of experience and exposure, right? Sure. So opportunities for us to kind of get out and experience anything and different things. I mean, I remember just growing up, every year we did kind of family vacations to different places where it was for the purpose of my parents giving us exposure to different ways of life and different things outside of where we lived in Memphis. And so I think that my parents have always been big on kind of exposure and putting yourself out there and taking risk. And I think that it's really scary. To your point, DC, it's really scary when you think about it. Sure. If all you know is kind of this place. But I think it is. I mean, there are certain times where you have to push into fear, push into uncertainty. And for me, like I left Memphis in high school. I haven't lived in Memphis since. Wow. I went to Cincinnati. I went to Chicago from there, Jersey, and then New York. And so each of those times it was scary and it was uncertain. But I think that every time you do it, it gets easier and easier.
Yeah.
And I think that it's just been immensely helpful in terms of broadening my horizons, broadening my experience and exposure, and broadening my network. I sure. still have folks back in Cincinnati that I can pick up the phone and call at P&G if I need something or if I have a question. So I think that it's really about experience, exposure, network, and just kind of leaning into fear, man.
You know, and you talk about this fear, but go out and do it. That's what it sounds like to me. Just go out and do it. And yep. if it's not successful, it's okay. We've got to teach our young folks that failure is only success turned inside out. And that's really true, man.
Absolutely.
Look at your life. I mean, look at where you are right now. I mean, you didn't, as I said earlier, you didn't start with Diageo. You had to start somewhere. And that's what I try to encourage my daughter, my son, and these other young folks. Just make a start. Half the game is really getting to the game is half the fight, right?
And I think that's beautiful, DC. I always say, like, make a decision and move and get to it. You can always make another decision. If you made the wrong decision, make another decision, right? Sure. Like, I've been in corporate America 15 years. So wow. 15 years since I graduated from college. And I've been at six different companies in wow. those 15 years.
Wow.
And it's like, yo, you make a decision. You don't know if it's the right decision, sure. but if it's not, then make another decision.
That's right.
That's all it is. And so it's just conditioning yourself, your mind, your body, just to kind of follow that mantra, I think, and that perspective, man.
I want to pivot right away from that to getting back to this COVID-19, how it's affected our corporate partners as well as folks in the community, especially impoverished people. But will we still see the level of support in terms of sponsorship, especially from the spirit industry? Will even more step up now that we've got this? And to be honest with you, I hate to call it a windfall, but you've done extremely well as an industry. So should more be asked of you now that in terms of we've got a lot of universities and colleges and a lot of them like to steer away from, of course, sponsorships from alcohol distributors and so forth. But sometimes you got to find the money where it is and say, look, we need your help. I'd like to get 200 college students back to Howard or back to Tennessee State or back to Lane or back to Texas College or Miles College. You know,
yep.
or Stillman College, I need you all to buy two. So I'm assuming that Diageo and some of these other major, hopefully Brown and I think Brown and Furman will step up and make sure mm-hmm. they are part of the process of getting our young people back to school. I think that's going to be one of the huge problems we'll be seeing here very soon.
Yeah, know? I think you'll see changes in terms of kind of for spirits companies and sponsorships. I mean, you're not going to see a lot of sponsorships of big events and things like that because sure. they're not happening, right?
Yes, right.
So, like, if you think about, like, football classics and festivals and things like that, those are not happening right now. So you're not gonna see a lot of support for those. I think spirits brands will need to pivot in terms of, like, putting their money into things that are much more meaningful for our communities, right?
Yes.
So how do we support our communities and what are those meaningful aspects where we can actually lend meaningful support in the places and spaces that it matter, that it matters? I know to your point, DC, I think when you talk about college and things, it gets a bit hairy just because of 21 plus audience and legally what spirits companies can do there. But there are absolutely ways that that spirits brands and companies can support communities that need it. And this is the time that we sure. as communities need it most. So I think you'll see a pivot to those more meaningful community activation and engagement type of things.
New York has been hit, man. Probably, I think any one city in our country, it's been hit probably hardest. When you have 15,000, now I know you have better than what I think is 11 million people or so in the city of New York, or a little bit more. And that sounds like a small, but try that being your cousin or your sister, your brother, your mother, your grandparent. Try that. And it won't be such a small number anymore. How have you been able to, from a mental standpoint, even though you're in corporate America, you're still living this life in New York City around the social distancing, the mask. But you, I'm sure you've had some people in your space that may have not made it, or either a relative not made it. How are you holding up?
Yeah, thanks for asking. I'm holding up. I'm holding up fine. I'll say that. Sure. I always look at kind of some other folks in other situations that are much more dire than mine. So I have no room to complain at all. Especially like in New York, I think if you don't know somebody that has been affected, you definitely know somebody who knows somebody. And the vast majority of us know somebody that have been affected, that have passed away or have where COVID has had a meaningful effect or impact on. I the way that I kind of hold up is obviously we're stuck in the house. We only leave the house when we need to go get essentials or whatever. And I think New York even makes it worse just because of subway, where you got thousands and millions crowded in one place. So, I mean, most of that, I think I read an article this morning that says 92%, the subway ridership is down 92%, which makes sense. Nobody wants to be crowded around other people in tight subway cars. But I tend to I read something that said, if there is one good thing that has come out of this, then we needed to go through, we as a nation needed to go through this experience. One good thing personally for you, right? Yeah. And that can be something small. Even for me, it's pretty small for me, but it's meaningful. So for me, it's I don't typically run, but now because I'm stuck in the house, I run around the neighborhood to get exercise, right? And it's making me a runner. Dare I say it's making me a runner, and I enjoy running, which I thought I would never say. But that's physical health and that's mental health because that helps me clear my mind. But that I think I challenge folks to think about if there's one good thing personally that has come out of this for you, then I think that's kind of what keeps me going and what says to me, okay, this is a shit, a terrible experience that, sorry, I didn't want to cuss.
No, this is fucking politics.
This is a shitty experience that none of us want to go through. But there is, I think there are small things that we can see that have come out of it for each of us, whether it's closer connections with family or friends, or whether it's different ways of doing things. That's how I try to think about it.
Well, and, you know, speaking of family, before we get out of here, because we got to get in just a minute or two, but before we do, your dad was recently, and I want to know people know Howard Robertson is one hell of a Kappa man, one hell of a father, one hell of a statesman and a civic servant here in our city. But he was recently in Ghana, and in some kind of way, this brother then found out that he's a royal priesthood. Now, tell me, what is Nana? I understand he gonna send a message back. Y'all gotta call me Nana now. I ain't calling you Nana. I know my Nana. You ain't my Nana. What's up with that, Ryan? Tell me what's up, bro.
Hey man, it was a great experience. So Nana means chief, basically.
Oh Lord, don't tell me you're in charge of something.
Look, they done
damn,
made
it. Damn, damn.
It was such a great experience, man. We went over there and went to kind of our ancestral village, and they welcomed us with open arms. I've never felt so welcome in a place or in a country like I have in Ghana. So it was a life-changing experience for us. They actually kind of crowned him chief, and that was great. They had a big, big celebration. And look, as typical with Black folks, especially in churches and villages, it was a 3-hour-long ceremony. Lord Jesus, because it was hot. But it was great, man. It was
so
great.
Did they pass a plate? Did they give Nana anything to come back with?
They passed a plate for us to leave something there. They ain't get out of here.
So now I gotta call this guy chief. Man, boy, this is one more thing I got to do with Kudzukian. You know, funky politics anyway. Hey, look, Ryan, man, thanks a lot for stopping by and talking with us here on Funky Politics, because I think the marketing piece, talking to our young folks, letting them know, hey, there is a way, take a chance, step out there. And remember, if you step out there and it does not succeed right away, it's okay. It's okay sometimes. Look at where you're at, Doc. And as I said before, you didn't just start out there yesterday. You had to go through to get to. And man, we appreciate you. We appreciate how you represent for us, brother. All right. So you hang in there. We appreciate you being on Funky Politics, and we'll, get you back again sometime soon. Okay.
Thank you, man. Thanks for having me. Take care, brother. Be safe.
We'll see you. All right, brother. We'll be back with more parting thoughts in just a second here on Funky Politics.
I feel good and make love good.
Oh. Nothing but the funk.
Riffin' on Jazz.
When two friends get together to kick it
about jazz, it's called Riffin' on Jazz.
Catch us Riffin' on Jazz every week right here on your favorite broadcast or podcast platforms.
Riffin' on Jazz on the Kudzukian Network.
I'm back on Funky Politics, and of course, Brother Ryan Robertson, who is no doubt going to go much higher than where he is right now. And this brother is, he's really out there. I mean, when you talk about innovation director and multicultural marketing, Diageo, the largest spirits company in the world, man, I could only see there's no limits. There's absolutely no limits to his growth potential. But I liked how he tried to also remind us that COVID-19 is here, the spirit industry is here, but we can still marry this thing together, and we can have the spirit industry step up and do a lot more community-oriented assist, because they've done well, and I think they understand that they're going to have to give back into our community. So we look forward to that. So I tell you what, I'm going to get out of here. On this show, we like to keep it real. We like to keep it right, and we like to keep it funky. Ryan Robertson has done that for us today. Even though he went to Ghana, he took his dad over there. Lord have mercy. Now Howard Robertson's a chief. Now we get all say hail to Howard Robertson. But anyway, I happen to like his wife. I like his mom. Beverly Robertson's a great lady as well. We'll see you back here again on Funky Politics, powered by the Kudzukian Network. I'm out of cheers.
Funky Politics, recorded at Kudzukian Studios, directed, produced, and distributed by Kudzukian.